Hey everyone, welcome to Aniki, the podcast about animes with two brothers. I'm Ben.
I'm Jonathan.
So excited. You're so excited to hear the resolution of this amazing mystery.
What's a good mystery?
So why don't you catch us up on what's been going on at the old Bunkasai this year?
Oh, at the old Bunkasai this year. One, everything is getting lost. Things are getting lost from various clubs and whatnot. Notes are being left by a strange character called Jumonji, which instead of being a creepy board game, is actually a guy stealing stuff slash is a pseudonym, which means 10 characters, because he's basically recreating the ABC murders from Christie, only a little less murdery and more taking random stuff. Also happening is good old manga drama, as Ibarra is trying to convince people at Manga Club that some manga are just great. Her case in point evidence is, of course, A Corpse by Evening. What else is happening? Good old Classics Club has ordered way too many copies of this year's issue of Hyouka. Instead of getting 30, they wound up with some 200. So they've been trying to slowly figure out a way to get rid of all these darn things. And this episode, they finally have. They've come up with a great way to get rid of all of them. Because it turns out, they're up next on Jumonji's list of people to lose things from.
They're on his hit list. So this show opens with Jitanda, who is doing her best on the radio show.
Yeah, it's Radio Tanda.
She is. And this time, she is not breaking the microphone.
No, she is not. Last
we
week
left
we,
last episode with her breaking the microphone.
Yep.
She's being asked, you know, can you catch this guy? Because that is the question on everyone's mind. Can Classics Club come to the rescue since you guys are great at all the mysteries?
All the mysteries.
Catch this dude. And she's like, oh yeah, yeah, we can with everyone's help because everything, if we all work together, and she looks at her crib notes because she's got a bunch of those.
Yep.
And under her radio broadcast, she has, be confident.
Yeah. She's usually
stress.
Bad at that.
Everyone.
Yep, everyone.
And then now at the bottom it says, pumpkins. For no reason, pumpkins. I have hashtag chemtrails here. So.
Yeah, everything's connected. Everything is connected by gold.
I really don't understand the pumpkins bit.
Pumpkins.
But she has written pumpkins.
She probably walked down the hallway and saw those pumpkin people and was like, pumpkins? Pumpkins.
Yes.
Need to look into that. Pumpkins? Pumpkins. Pumpkins.
Yeah. So while she's on the radio, she's on the radio and the whole school can hear her.
Yeah, because it's over the PA system, basically.
Yeah, we cut to a Satoshi who is in the stairwell being very, very depressed.
You mean Sad-Toshi?
He is Sad-Toshi in this
Sad-Toshi?
Episode.
Sad-Toshi? Yeah.
Sad-Toshi.
Sad-Toshi.
Jitanda then announces that Classics Club tribute to Jumonji will be a completed manuscript of their own Hyouka.
Yeah, buddy. While we do this, we get a shot of Sad Ibarra in the geo prep room, and we see, first off, she notices, you know, some copies of Hyouka have disappeared off the stacks. Not only that, but we do get a brief shot of Oreki's bad math. Did you
yes.
take the time to try and solve?
I didn't count them. I just like, oh no, not this. I'm skipping
bad
it.
Math.
No.
Let's see here. What do we have written on the bottom here? We're gonna do a good stopperoo. Something about 173 and 137 and.
Yeah. Well, we cut back to Jitanda, who's got some more notes, which are advertise Hyouka.
All right.
Which she does.
She does.
And more pumpkins. They're everywhere. They're invading. They're invading her mind. They're whispering to her. Tell them more about Hyouka, Jitanda. Tell them. Yay. She's really enthusiastic, though, about this whole thing.
I love how she's advertising as hard as she can by being like, if it wouldn't be any trouble, you could maybe. Maybe buy a Hyouka while you're there. Because her whole pitch is, right, it's like, in order to catch Jumonji, what you're going to do is, we know he's going to hit Classics Club, so everybody come to Classics Club, and we can catch him in the act, because everybody's going to be there, and everybody's going to be looking at it. And please, if he's not too much trouble, you could maybe buy a copy of Hyouka, please.
What I like about this is we cut to Irisu, who, A, is contemplating buying a stuffed frog, which opens up a whole door on her personality that we haven't had yet. Yeah.
She can like cute stuff.
But also, she looks at the speaker, the PA speaker, and gives it this really sad, pitiful look.
Well, you know, Jitanda tries.
Some wires might have gotten crossed.
She does her best. Let's put it that way.
That's a good way to put it.
Look, her secret weapon, instead of being a spider, is being as moe as I'll get out. So, you know, in a way, it works out for her.
It does. It does. So the radio show's over, and Radio Bucho is congratulating her. But Chitanda's sad. She's wondering, was this the right thing to do?
Was I too forward in asking people to buy Hyouka?
The answer was yes.
But it worked.
I like how tired out she is, because this whole asking favors thing is just not something she does.
It's not her thing.
Not her thing.
Not her thing. So we get the op, and we get this episode's title, which is Kudrovka's Order.
I couldn't spell that. I didn't want to try and spell that. So I just wrote space dog every time that came up in my notes. It's just space dog. So near the end, when we get some super serious stuff concerning the title of, you know, that manga, I have just like super deep stuff where it's like, oh, it's so depressing about these new revelations about space dog comic.
Space dog. I like that better than what we've got.
What, space dog comic?
Space dog. Space I'm dog. For it.
Dead space dog. Oh.
Yeah, so we cut to...
the cutest poster ever?
Yes, yes, yes. Because there's a bunch of people that are waiting outside the Geo Prep Room now to actually buy Hyouka. Because everybody
wants to be a part of this.
Is already there. And they're like, well, we're going to catch Jumonji for one. But two, I guess I'll buy one of those things because apparently there's mysteries and stuff.
Yeah, mysteries.
But you know how in front of Manga Club for the past couple days, there have been amazing signs?
We've got one.
Someone's done that here.
It's got to be Ibarra, right? Like, this is Ibarra who's done this.
I hope.
She's in Manga Club.
So it's got like... chibi versions of all of the club members fighting a vaudevillian mustachioed dastardly devil.
What's it say on his mask? Because those aren't the characters for Jumonji. I'm also curious of what it says over on Oreki, because this poster has our gang on one side and Jumonji on the other. It makes it look like Satoshi is like the ringleader of defeating mysteries here on this.
Yeah, because he's doing the old
objection pose. The girls, Chitanda's like fight though. Ibarra just looks upset, and Oreki's just in the background being sad. But he's holding a little sign, too, but I don't know what it says. They didn't translate it. It says something about Hyouka.
Oh, it just says Jumonji on his mask.
Really? It doesn't look like... yeah, I guess so. I guess now that I see how...
it's written vertically. And then on Oreki,
this classic club, Hyouka, and then the other thing...
yeah.
Probably like fight, because they use chu for like a continuing verb. I have no idea. It's way too small.
Yeah, it's pretty teeny tiny.
Oh, maybe it's support. Please support.
Oh,
because I think the first one's Onegai.
Oh, then you're probably right then. Yeah.
But yeah, he's nonplussed. He doesn't care. Ibarra's just annoyed.
Well, that's some really long exegesis on a stupid poster that's super cute.
Yep. So, yeah, inside the room, people are buying, and Oreki is
just the happiest. He doesn't even have to do his fake smile. Just give me the dollars. All the dollars. Dollar bills.
Yeah, all the others, though, are standing around a desk that has been placed in the center of the room, and upon it is the original manuscript.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to take some Mission Impossible level nonsense to get that thing.
Somebody's going to be descending from the ceiling in a rope here in a minute. It's going to be the Boondock Saints all over again. It's going to bust through the top and just spin around.
Is there going to be a firefight?
There was a firefight. Either that or the manuscript's going to get serial crushed by some huge frigging guy.
There will be a firefight.
Ooh, you're right. After a while, everybody in the room starts getting really suspicious. They catch on to Oreki's clever ruse. Like, wait a minute, could this have just been a thing just to get us in here and buy the thing?
Did they just make this up? Maybe they started making this up.
But then Oreki has a bit of a stretch. Bit of a stretch.
He's like, things are almost sold out. Oh, such a hard day.
A hard day's work. A hard day's night.
And then Satoshi's phone goes off.
Oh, wow.
And everyone's like, what?
Oh, dude. What? Dude, you can totally catch it in this scene.
I want to see it.
Okay, now go back to the beginning of the scene.
Yeah.
All right, just the whole scene here.
Uh-huh.
You can see, over on the left, you'll see somebody tugging their hair. I think you'll know who it is. Standing over by Chitanda. I don't want to reveal anything yet. Suspense.
By the door?
Yeah.
Yep.
Seeing grabbing his hair. All right, so here we go. Here we go. We're going to go through the scene. And go through the scene, blah, blah, blah. Everybody's impossible. Everybody's waiting, tapping their feet, tapping their shoulder. Yeah,
Maybe they're just doing it themselves.
There's a stretch. And here a phone rings. And if you look over on the right, you can see somebody with their... See how well this is? This is such a well-done show.
I didn't even notice
because
that.
Because, again, you yourself don't notice it, right? Because the phone, spoilers, is a distraction, right? Obviously. Because
obviously.
Even if you're distracted. Not... even if you don't know the solution, you already are pretty sure that the phone's going to be a distraction.
Yeah, so if you're not watching it with us right now, because I doubt you are, Stosh's phone rings, everyone is shocked, very Bakuti.
Yep.
And then suddenly, the manuscript bursts into flames.
Yeah, just ignites.
Like, explodes. Like, I'm gonna keep watching the scene.
Oh, yeah, here we go. Oh, wow, yeah, that's really good, too. You see somebody reach into their pocket as well.
Mm-hmm.
The same somebody that may have had a phone.
Ooh. Chitanda is, well, Satoshi puts it out.
Yeah.
Satoshi puts out the
manuscript
fire,
just bursts into flames.
Throws it to the ground and punches it out like a man.
Yeah. Punches
like
it.
This is spoilers though. This is probably the only time during the episode Satoshi's going to act manly.
Oh. Look.
So
being in touch with your feelings doesn't make him any less manly. It's called toxic masculinity right there, brother. Gotta watch out for that.
Sorry. Anyway, he punches it.
He does punch it. He lifts it up in the air in sort of a dejected thing. Either way, on the ground, Ibarra has found a copy, an issue of Hyouka with a note in it. It's the same note as usual, but now there's a little bit extra here. At the bottom, it says the 10 letters are now complete.
And then we get Oreki looking not impressed.
Yeah.
And Satoshi, still holding the burnt manuscript aloft, looks back at him with some death glares.
Yeah, he is dejected.
For multiple reasons.
Yeah, after school, we move to after school scene. We're done with the big letdown at Hyouka at Classics Club. The big letdown. Chitanda even sees the evening edition of the school newspaper, and it says that Classics Club was defeated. Couldn't do it.
She sighs very heavily, but is gladdened a little bit that Irisu, who she meets in a moment,
yeah,
sold all the issues of Hyouka.
Yes,
she did want to sell them at full price, mm-hmm, but you know, Chitanda's okay with
that. Deal's
a deal. She's like, this is more than enough. This is more than we deserve.
So
she's such a pushover.
She is, isn't she? She's too prim and polite.
And then as Chitanda's about to leave, Irisu stops her.
He's like, should I? I don't know. I don't know if I should be telling you this.
One more thing. Let me, I should probably tell you something.
Let me tell you some secrets.
And she's like, oh no, wait, no, thanks for your advice earlier. I just, and Irisu's like, yeah.
Yeah.
About that.
Turns out you're super bad at being a spider. Just don't. She says, and I quote, when you try to control people using expectations, you sound completely dependent on them.
And she's not wrong.
She is not wrong. Chitanda is too straightforward for her own good. But the sort of good news is she's able to like own that in a super moe way, which makes people want to do what she says anyway, but it's not very becoming.
Yeah, she's like, your weapon is that you can get right to the point and throw people off guard.
Yep.
So you should just keep doing what you're doing. Eventually you'll figure it out. It'll be fine.
Chitanda, you do you. And Chitanda's like, oh yeah, thanks. I'd already sort of figured that out, honestly, because this is terrible and I hate doing it.
Your way is really tiring.
Too much work. I'd rather just lean over and say Kini Narimasu and give him the old glowy eyes. Give him the old baby perps.
So then we cut to Rival-san.
Ah, Hikaru no Go, just go away. Just leave.
No, he can't leave yet. He's busy being a dick.
He is, isn't he?
He's like, huh, Satoshi,
looks like you could,
how about that?
Looks like you
didn't
could
catch
figure
him?
Out.
That sucks for you.
Yeah, I thought I had expectations that you could do it. And Satoshi is like, look, son, we're going to have some talk about how the word expectations should be used.
Well.
Because he's kind of non-confrontational with people that aren't
like,
in his
dude, feet. Just go away. Just,
Hikaru no Go, you're the worst. You're the worst part of this whole arc. I'm calling it now. Worst thing of the whole arc is stupid Hikaru no Go.
I'll buy that.
Yeah, good.
So Ibarra wanders up and is like, who is that? And for some reason, Satoshi was not, man.
Just some idiot.
Some guy I know.
I have no idea. He thinks I'm like a rival.
He's talking to him, but I have no idea who he is.
It's like how IU likes to pretend that they're rivals of Purdue at football.
Yeah.
It's like, you're not, yeah, guys. You're not. Purdue could care less.
What he actually says is kind of weird. Mm-hmm. He says, that's Tani-kun. Apparently that's his real name. No idea. Yeah. Don't care. He's Rival-san.
Yeah, he's Rival-san / Hikaru no Go.
And he sucks at Japanese.
Yep.
Like, oh, okay.
That's weird.
He uses the word expectations too easily. And holy crap, if we don't get this line for the rest of the episode.
What, how expectations are supposed to go?
This episode of Hyouka is brought to you by E and the word
expectations. It's true.
In fact, great expectations.
It was the best of times. It was the blurst of times. That's Tale of Two Cities, not Great Expectations, but you know what I mean.
So Ibarra, just like here, is saying, well, whatever, who cares? And Satoshi's like, no, I have some things to say.
Yeah, look. Now, I think what we're getting at here is some of the fact that, you know, the Japanese language and Japanese cultural use of language, like expectations and things, asking favors in the Japanese language gets very complex.
Yes.
And I think that's sort of what we're going off here, right? Is that we're not just getting at, you know, when he's saying that Hikaru is bad at Japanese because he uses expectations too easily, he's saying it, I think, from a Japanese point of view as the usage of that word.
Yeah, that makes sense. I hadn't really considered that angle.
If you're going to say you have expectations of somebody, it means you really kind of do. It means you're actually sort of asking a sort of favor without asking a favor about something. Because directly asking people to do stuff is...
And then you have to do the whole bowing, very, like Risu did in the movie arc.
It's a big to-do.
Yeah.
It's a big to-do.
So
I think that's what we're getting at, and which is why Satoshi
says
he's bad at Japanese.
Yeah, that sort of makes what he says next a little more clear, but it's still kind of... I don't know exactly what he's saying,
yeah.
Even with the rest of the episode as context. Because yeah. He says, you can't say the word expectations when you have confidence in yourself.
Yeah. So his claim here is that you shouldn't go around saying you expect others to do things if you think you are able to do it yourself.
I guess.
Yeah, I think that's what he's getting at, right? Because if I think I can handle something on my own, I shouldn't expect you to take care of it, right? And that's what he's saying here, right? Because Tani-kun... fully thought he could solve the Jumanji thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he shouldn't throw around words like, oh, I expected you would be able to get it. Because, you know, dude, you thought you could do it. You shouldn't pin your hopes and dreams on somebody else when you thought you were the one who could do it.
Yeah, it makes sense. It makes sense. Satoshi follows that up with, that's what you have, just expectations,
yeah.
When you've given up.
Yeah, like, you have to rely on others. Because,
yeah, from our perspective as English speakers and in America, none of what he's saying right now makes any kind of sense.
Yeah. Because of how we use the phrase expectations.
Yeah, I come at it from the whole let's ask people for things. Yeah.
Yeah, like
that makes sense. I like that.
Yeah, it's a bit of weird cultural dissonance, right? Because, yeah, culturally speaking, the Japanese tend to be far more communal-based. You should rely on other people to do stuff rather than how individualistic we are here in the West and stuff. And that puts another spin on his little speech here.
Yeah, that does make the resolutions, plural, make a little more sense.
Yeah.
Although... not completely.
Yeah, but I think that's what we're getting at here.
So, Satoshi follows this up with a really good example of what he's talking about.
Yeah, well, at least internally, because I don't think he tells Ibarra this, because we're going
to
get,
we get a flashback to end all flashbacks.
Yes, by a flashback to end all flashback, you mean...
No, wait, that's Tenjou Tenge. Tenjou Tenge is the flashback to end all flashback. I take that back. This is the flashback to end all Hyouka flashback.
Yeah, because this is about a 5-minute flashback.
So, what we have here is a flashback to when Satoshi... at some point in the past, and it's important that we don't know when. We just know that it happened probably within the last day and a half.
Yeah, because it had to happen between...
It was after the cooking thing.
Yeah, well, it had to have happened after their discussion on the bridge from last week's episode. And before things lit on fire earlier today. Before the Jumanji incident.
In the last day, this has happened.
Yes.
But it didn't happen just, like, right before this.
Yeah.
So... he spies Oreki in front of the accusing bike rack.
We're not in an accusing parlor. We're at an accusing bike rack outside the school.
With none other than the vice president of student council.
Now, I'm a little confused here of whether or not, from Satoshi's point of view, he can see who Oreki is talking to. I don't think he can.
I don't know. I don't think he can either.
Because he doesn't react to anything until we get the full... Oreki says it out loud, full thing. But yes, Oreki is at the bike rack with Tanabe, and that is the vice president.
That's important. And he says, j'accuse.
Yeah. So Tanabe, senpai, you're super Jumanji, right? It's like, what? Am I?
That seems like a wild guess.
That seems like this coming out of left field. And he's like, oh, really? He's ready.
He has a bunch of notes in his head.
Oh, yeah, he does.
So now we get a cues and response for many things.
We're gonna line item this freaking thing down and show you how it all makes sense and how you're dumb for not having figured it out earlier.
Clearly. So first of all, why in the world would you say lost and not taken in your notes?
Yeah.
Or at least Jumonji.
Yeah.
Why would he not say that?
Why would he not do that?
Number two, you skipped coup.
Yeah, that's true.
But what if there was a coup that was something else we weren't aware of?
Yeah, maybe coup wasn't skipped after all.
Maybe, what if it's a someone? Maybe if this whole thing was a message for someone.
Yeah. Hmm.
A message saying that someone whose name starts with coup had already lost something that started with coup.
Huh. How weird would that be? Be real weird. Be real strange.
Tanabe's response is, well, that's awfully complicated.
Yeah. It's like, have you followed along with Hyouka? It's very complicated for no good reason.
He's like, did you just listen to yourself? Because that just sounds like madness.
It sounds like there's chemtrails in the water and we should be buying gold, Oreki. Sounds like the pumpkins are the reason for everything.
No, not. Not if the recipient of the message knew how to decode it.
Yeah, because that's probably what the plot was of Space Dog.
Shock face.
He's like, hey, Tanabe. He's like, hey, Tanabe, has anybody taught you about Updog? And Tanabe's like, what's up, dog? He's like, ha! That's right.
Yeah, Tanabe has super shock face.
Yeah.
Because he was not expecting Kudrovka's order, aka Space Dog, to come up at this point in time.
Kudrovka's, of course, starts with Ku.
And Oreki's like, so, how did I know that?
How did I know that? Because I'm too smart for my own good. And Tanabe was not ready to come up against me being bored. Either me being bored or Chitanda being curious, or, more important than both of those, me needing to sell a bunch of these stupid books.
So he explains. It's a variation on the ABC murders.
Of Christmas.
And, well, that's what Space Dog is. Yeah. It's a variation on the ABC murders. And this, all this, is a variation on Space Dog.
On Space Dog.
The message is meant for someone with Ku in their name.
And I know who it is.
Like, say,
Kugayama Muneyoshi. A hot student council president. Could it be
an artist
for him?
Of
A Corpse by Evening.
A Corpse by Evening.
Woohoo! And we get a retort with, well, Kugayama isn't a club, you idiot. You're dumb. All the others are clubs. You're dumb. What a dumb. What a dummy. You're dumb.
Where he's like, there's no rule saying it only has to be clubs.
The only rule we know of is that their name has to appear on this page of the brochure.
Yep, that last page.
Yeah, the page. You know what else is on that page of the brochure? The committee. The executive committee's names. And chief among the executive committee is, of course, Kugayama Muneyoshi.
Mm-hmm. I like this, though, because he's like, yeah, all the clubs come, and then Kugayama's name is right after that. Yep. It's a dead giveaway, son.
Yeah.
Because only the executive committee can control those names.
Well, Tanabe's like, well, there's like 20 people on that. Like, it could be Satoshi. Like, I don't know about nothing.
And Oreki's like, ah, good point. But that's why I can mangas.
Yeah. That's why I figured everything out.
Because I read mangas.
Yeah, so I read this manga, right? And The Course by Evening is really... it's really what brings this whole story together. Because look, we know who the artist was. That was Kugayama, right? Right. We know who the writer was. It was Anjo, right? Right. So the real question is who's the background artist? Right? Right. So here's the deal. So it's very likely that good old Kugayama has lost the manuscript for the Space Dog manga, right?
Right. Right.
That's the idea, at least. So whoever put this whole incident into motion, i.e. probably the background artist of Corpse by Evening, right, is probably trying to guilt trip this guy because he lost the script for the best manga of all time, right?
Correct.
So that means that the background artist of Corpse by Evening has to be Jumanji. And now look at the name of the author, quote-unquote, of Corpse by Evening. It's Ajimu Takuha, right?
That's a weird name. What a weird name.
Weird name.
That's silly.
So here's the deal. How about instead of it being a silly name, it's a stupid cryptogram that's real easy to crack once you think about it.
It's the first letters of all your names.
Yeah. So it's Anjo Haruka, right? It's
Haruka. Yep.
So there's our A and Ha. And we've got Kugayama Muneyoshi for the...
Ku and Mu.
Yeah, Ku and Mu. So good. Okay, so here's the deal. We are looking for somebody who participated in last year's festival. So they're second year or higher or higher. They have to be on the executive committee. There's somebody whose first and last name start with Ta and G, since those are the two things left from the title. Furthermore, the person must have been a friend of President Kugayama, and who knows, he could have drawn manga. Therefore, you, Tanabe Jiro.
And from behind the wall, Satoshi, overhearing this, is mortified.
He's like, seriously? Seriously? How do you do this?
Who are you?
Are you a wizard?
The answer is yes.
He is a wizard. He inherited it from his sister, who's a witch. Don't ask me how he inherited it from his sister. We'll worry about that later. And it gets... It's in my Jojinchi. It's very, very well written.
It's very tasteful.
You just gotta read it, and you'll see how it all works out.
And to this, Tanabe's like...
We get a real hashtag slow clap. An actual slow clap. It's great. I have it here.
I only thought the other ones would decode this message.
Yeah. Here's what I like. In my notes, I wrote, hashtag slow clap. Meanwhile, the eavesdropping Satoshi's mind is being blown in speedwagon-esque proportions. He's exploding over here. Like, even while Oreki is explaining the whole bit with the names, we get a graphic of the names all splitting up and the comic.
Yeah, and you just have
Satoshi just being like, how does he do this?
He's a broken man.
He's a wizard. He's a mystery wizard.
And so Satoshi says to himself during the flashback, Oreki has exceeded my expectations.
Yeah, buddy. Talk about it.
Here's the word again. Yep. I need a bell.
Yeah.
Ding. Ding.
A little counter.
So it exploded Satoshi's mind so much that it actually broke the episode and they go to commercial.
Yeah. Poor Satoshi, man.
He's the raw end of all this.
Here's what I love is, again, like, this is all evidence we are given in the show. And if we had taken enough time to figure it all out, we may have been able to do it. Especially,
yeah, I mean, given infinite time.
Especially given what really you could figure it out right before this because of the evidence we get literally early on in this episode. I'm surprised they put that in there instead of leaving it, you know, in shadow or just not having
it's
it.
It's for when you come back and you're like,
Yeah, he did. Whoa, huh.
How about that? So yeah, maybe you're wondering what we're talking about. Let us get to that part.
Let us get back. So we come back from the break. We have some more questions to answer.
Well, now it's Oreki's questions.
Yeah, because Oreki's like, now come on, this
is silly.
This whole message is so convoluted for no good reason.
Yeah, why be so indirect?
Why would you be so infinitely indirect?
Are you just keeping the spirit of Anjo Haruna around after she transferred? Because that seems sort of silly.
Tanabe laughs and it's like, yeah, but it was also because it's the school festival and it seemed like a fun time. But also,
we like screwing around with the old Kanyasai. It's fun.
Also, mostly
what us executive committees get up to behind closed doors.
Also, it's because I'm a giant coward and my life is a lie.
Here we get the first of many dramas.
of many truth bombs and real talks. This episode is full of them. For being a show about nothing, it sure does get very, like, teen angst all up ends all the time.
Yeah, so Tanabe could not tell Kugayama his true feelings. But Oreki doesn't really care about that. He's like, anyway, yeah, so one more thing while we're talking.
How about some blackmail?
Okay. Yeah, could you do something since I figured out that you're a jerk face? How about you buy 30 copies of this good old Hyouka? It's very entertaining.
How about you do this?
Amazing stuff. He's doing a lot of hand waving here.
Oreki has found a brand new career path, which is going to suit his personality perfectly.
Yeah.
He would be great as a blackmail artist. Just fantastic.
Well, yeah.
Because he could figure out all sorts of dumb stuff and then just be like, so if you don't want people to know all this dumb stuff I can figure out,
buy my stuff.
Because it's like he's walking by some salaryman's house and sees them throw away a magazine. It's like, Oh, you threw away a magazine? That means you're actually a corporate spy. And here's all the reasons why, so please pay me dollars.
Well, Tanabe says, whoa, you're blackmailing me? Or he's like, yep.
Yep. Not put too fine a point on it, but absolutely I am.
Totally. But to be fair, it won't be you. It'll be the executive committee buying them.
I'm technically blackmailing the executive committee. So please buy all these. Now, Why is he trying to get them to buy these? Well, remember a couple episodes ago where he's poking around the computer? Yeah, they sell stuff online. You know where they can sell Hyoukas? Online. He's like, yeah, you're going to do that for me. Tanabe's like, now, hold on.
Yeah.
Wait up.
Whoa.
The executive committee is only going to put stuff online that is real popular. Like, it's got to be popular. And Oreki's like, but Hyouka will be popular after I kidnap the Queen of England. And each bison dollar will be worth 5 British pounds. Wait. That's the plot of Street Fighter.
Yeah, I think you've crossed some streams there. No, here is just, hey, you know this Jumoji thing that you've been doing? It is tearing stuff up.
Yeah, that's going to make it super popular. So instead of kidnapping the queen, here's what you're going to do.
You're going to make Classic Club your last target. Me and some other guy, I don't know who,
probably
will,
like,
support
Satoshi.
You in the crime.
Yeah.
Satoshi from behind the wall.
Like, what?
Like,
I have, what? I'm not greedy.
I know. But what?
No one's checked with me, Satoshi. I was too busy catching Pokemon. I don't know.
Or he finishes up with, just think of the publicity, with insiders helping in a crowded room.
Yeah, buddy.
It's a win-win,
we'll
man.
We'll be selling these things left and right. Hotcakes won't have nothing on Hyouka. People will be selling pancakes and be like, those sell as well as Hyouka.
Tanabe thinks about this for a second. He's like, yeah.
All right.
That's
but
a
how
win-win.
Are you going to do it? It's got to be something cool, right? He's like, all right. You want something cool.
I have a plan.
Have you ever heard of sodium?
Ever heard of this thing called chemistry?
Chemistry? Well, it turns out Science Club is putting on a demonstration of how sodium, you know, explodes and how that's real cool. How about you, Mr. Executive Committee Vice President, go get some sodium.
Yeah, get some sodium. I'll put it in the manuscript, and you can shoot it with a water gun.
From
I know
pumpkins.
Some creepy pumpkins.
I know some pumpkins you can get
who have one.
And Tanabe's like, dude, that's kind of twisted.
And Oreki gets
he's so delighted
the
with himself.
Best face.
He's like,
it is the smuggest, most full of himself yeah. face.
He says with a
he's
smirk.
Like, yeah, it's a festival though. It'll be fun.
Yeah, let's finish it off with a bang.
Oh, I love it.
I think it's the first time in the entire series we've seen, I think, his true side.
Where he just has that bit of a morbid fun to him.
Well, he's like, not only have I bested you and everyone I know, but let's set things on fire.
Yeah, let's do something real zany here. Like,
he's channeling
really
some
it.
Of Astronomy Club here.
Oh, yeah.
Meanwhile, behind him, Satoshi is sad.
Satoshi makes a comeback.
He's very sad. Very sad.
We missed out on a little bit more of the plan. Satoshi's phone is going to get called. It's the idea that right before things go down, Oreki will stretch his super obvious stretch, and then Tanabe can call Satoshi's cell phone. And if you go back to the beginning of the episode,
that's totally
it's
what
actually
happened.
In the frames. It's actually in the art that happens. Yep. You can see Tanabe in the room. You can see him call when everybody else looks on the phone. You can see he has his phone out. And you can see
he doesn't have his phone out. He has his phone in the pocket.
Yep. Yep.
So he's calling it from his pocket. Everyone turns, and suddenly things explode, yep. And Tanabe is the only person in the room turned away from the...
Yeah, it's real well done. I'm surprised they even put that in there. Most shows wouldn't.
It's
they would
really
just,
good.
They would just frame it out. They just would be like, oh, well, whatever.
He's just in
frame.
The background enough.
Yeah.
Like, he's a background character total through and through, except for he has Tanabe hair.
Yep, he just does a couple of little things. You can see his phone. You can see him reach
really
his
good
pocket
direction
for the squirt gun. Well done.
To finish up this whole confrontation, Tanabe's like, okay, fine. You win. Everything... sounds legit.
We'll do that thing.
So, but who are you again? Oreki Hotaru
from
Class 1B.
Remember it.
And Satoshi's spirit is crushed in a hydraulic press.
Basically. Poor guy.
He's done.
He can't win for losing.
Nope. But that's the end of our flashback.
And we come back with some hashtag real talk Ibarra Satoshi edition. Toot woo. Toot.
Very toot toot. Ibarra's like, so are you talking about expectations between you and Oreki? Like those kind of expectations?
Toot toot. It's another good ship. Yes, please. No, we mean expectations of how Satoshi super idolizes Oreki and constantly wants to show off his talent and expects that Oreki can solve every mystery ever put in front of him, and he'd better, or I'm going to be super depressed about stuff.
Very much so.
Ibarra can read Satoshi like a book in this aspect. It's like, yeah. I can tell that's exactly how you are. And she asks the real question. It's like, did you, Satoshi, honestly want to try and beat Oreki this time?
He's like, well, kind of.
Would have been nice.
Yeah.
But then he puts back on his little faux mask and is like, well, you know, should have known that you can't because, you know, databases can't draw conclusions. I'm not crying. I'm totally just pollen.
Ibarra, I think she gets it.
She does.
She grabs the tail of his coat yeah. for support. Insert a big old
toot toot.
Aww. Toot toot. He's so cute. Aww.
From there, we cut to the actual closing ceremony. Kugayama giving the ending speech, talking about the Jumonji incident. When he brings that up, he does turn around and give a big old winkaroo to Tanabe. Message coming through loud and clear.
He knew, kind of.
He even chuckles about it. Like, he got me. He got me, brah.
Yeah. He's like, there seems to have been a strange incident. Everyone laughs. And Tanabe's guilt rises. There's so much guilt. He has so much guilt. So, as the teardown happens...
we still have one other loose thread, and it's manga drama, gosh darn it.
Back to this.
We gotta deal with the end of the manga drama.
Ibarra is bringing a corpse by evening, finally, to Reimu on the Bridge of Tears, which is now its name. She's like, look, I know I brought this late, but seriously, the author of this manga is gonna write a masterpiece someday.
Yeah, like this is legit. This is the best manga ever. Like, I remember this other manga I was going to bring. It was going to be real good. It was, like, Body Talk or something. I don't know. That thing's like poop. But here, we got Corpse by Evening. And this is the real stuff here. This is legit.
For reals.
For reals. Like, the other stuff, Body Talk, I don't even, Body what? I don't know. Body, no one's talking about it because Corpse by Evening is so great.
Now, does she actually bring up Body Talk
she does
in this conversation?
Not. She doesn't. That is important
like,
that she doesn't.
I can't remember her saying that because that would make this a lot more
It would make it
coherent.
Way worse, as we will soon see. That is some editorializing by your host.
So yeah, she's like, this isn't my copy, but you knew about this manga already, didn't you? And Rainbow's like, damn that Mangabucho.
Yeah. Good old Mangabucho.
Yeah, yeah, we're all friends. I'm friends with the writer, something, something, whatever. Yeah. I haven't heard from her in a while. Whatever. Something, something, feelings.
Feelings. So basically, yeah, Dime Store Reimu gets super defensive about the whole thing because when she started reading Corpse by Evening, she instantly knew that it was super great. And
like the best thing she's ever read.
Yeah, and that Anjo had that spark of talent that, you know, not everybody does. And that's also when Dime Store Reimu realized that she doesn't have that same spark that Anjo has. And in my notes, I just have hashtag no bummers.
All the bummers. No, you're getting all of them right now.
She,
right to the face.
Reimu is also like, come on. Where she does? Anjo didn't even read manga. She just sort of decided to write one, and she does this.
Mm-hmm.
Capital D drama.
She also explains a little bit without going directly into talking about her relationship with Anjo.
Yeah.
She talks about her perspective on this whole thing. And she's like, when you are reading these kinds of things, how are you actually supposed to know if they're good? Like, if I only read comedies, why in the world would I read A Course by Evening? Because that's not a comedy. Or why would I even read mangas if I only like watching Star Wars or something? And Ibarra's like, well, sure you would, because some things are just good enough to be consumed regardless of what you like. And Reimu's like, only to those who understand the difference. And then Ibarra calls out to her. And here the music swells, and the camera pulls back to a wide angle on the Bridge of Tears. And Reimu jumps off the building, and everything gets really dark really fast.
And then Boogiepop Phantom shows up, and wait, huh?
No, wait, she was just joking.
No.
She takes out a marker and draws Dick Butt on the side of the railing.
Okay, now that would be sweet. Honestly, that would make me crack up.
No, she takes out a marker and writes a thing on the railing.
Yeah, she starts drawing something on the railing.
And this is where she like gives Ibarra the whole thing where, you know, she actually hasn't read that whole thing. Yeah. She stopped halfway
I was like, I can't deal with this. She's my good friend who barely likes manga is infinitely better than this than I am.
Yeah, so she threw it in a closet, hasn't looked at it since, doesn't want to see it.
She's never going to see it.
No thanks.
She's not
going to
do it. But every time it always comes back, gets brought up, and I just can't deal with it.
And then we bring it full circle because Ibarra starts talking about expectations and mimics everything Satoshi just said in that giant flashback.
Yeah. She walks over to the railing to see what Reimu has drawn, and she has drawn
and
a little cartoon
cat. It's a
dick
butt. Dick
butt. It's not dick butt. This is very dramatic, and you just got
it'd be so much funnier, though.
I mean, it would be. No.
She sees a cat.
She draws the cartoon cat that's on the back of Body Talk, and she's just like, Ibarra's like, oh no. Because if you remember, Body Talk was way back when she was trying to find Corpse by Evening. The other thing she could find was Body Talk, and she's like, well, this one's real good. Like, this is a real good manga, but you know, it's not a Corpse by Evening. Corpse by Evening is just better than this, and I could bring this to Manga Club to show Reimu how masterpieces are, but this one, it's just not on the same level.
This sort of brings into where she thought that her own work was so far below
Body Talk.
Reimu feels that way about A Corpse by Evening.
Yeah.
And so, of course, the weeping commences.
Yeah.
Her sleeves are soaked by tears.
Look, why do you gotta be full of bummers today? I just want a good little mystery, and instead you're just all bummers. Just infinite bummers.
To get away from the bummers, we cut back to the club room.
Yes, let's go back to the club room where people are having a good time.
Where Oreki has amazingly sold so many copies.
Yep. What I have here about his bad math is evidently if there's just 4 copies left, then there's nothing for the backlog, nor is there one for the advisor.
Well, they already sold those.
Did they sell those first? No, they...
Did they?
No, Oreki said not that they were going to buy, but he assumed they would be bought. There's a difference.
Oh, that is a good point.
Yeah, he did say that. Granted, we do
work... There shall be no Hyouka in the archives.
Yeah, later on in the episode, we do find out that these 4, they're going to buy as second copies. So it's not completely
I'm sure
wrong.
Oreki would give up one of his.
Yeah, I'm sure he would. But yeah, they all...
And Satoshi, to this news that they've sold them all, is hamming it up. How did we do this? This is so amazing.
Yeah.
Look, guys, we're so great.
Who could do this? Oreki now flashes back to being like, yeah, I guess I can't tell Chitanda that I sold all these through blackmail. That would be a bad...
Chitanda is so overjoyed,
oh,
and she
yeah.
says, this is better than expected.
Ooh.
Ding.
Ding.
And Oreki becomes sad because she just used the bad word.
Yeah, which is expectations.
And we get more flashbacks.
Yeah. More flashbacks. Because basically, Oreki is now a little confused in the flashback. He's now a little confused of like, was the motive truly that Kugayama lost the manuscript? Because Oreki was just sort of searching for a motive here, and he just sort of guessed that maybe that was it, right? Like, yeah. Maybe. Tanabe fills him in that that's not the reason. Basically, the reason is Kugayama has had the manuscript. He probably hasn't even read it. He doesn't want to draw anymore. He drew last year just because he wanted to. He felt like it would be a fun hobby, and he drew it on a whim. Like a masterpiece manga that was super amazing and super great.
What a waste.
And he just...
I had so many expectations.
Yep. That's such a good job tying all the themes together. Not only from this arc, but from last arc, too, because that expectations was Irisu's watchword to try and get Oreki involved in crap, too, back when he was having his crippling self-doubt.
But yeah, Tanabe's message never actually got to Kugayama.
At least that's
so
what
the
he
whole
thinks.
Thing was pointless. Yeah, well, that's what he assumes.
But we didn't find out in the present. This is a bit out of order. They really should have put this earlier. That way we have the more of the emotional punch when we find out that Kugayama really did get his message.
Well, kind of, I think. I don't know that he got his message. I think he just figured out who was doing it.
That's possible.
Because remember, one of his reasons for doing it was, let's just screw with the Kanya side because it's funny.
Yeah.
And I think, given the wink and the nod, that's what Kugayama got out of it.
Maybe.
It's like, good job. That's a good joke. I like it.
The goof. Yeah, maybe.
And that's why Tanabe was very, but I didn't do it for the goofs.
Yeah.
I did it for the art.
Yeah.
Love me, senpai.
To get real deep here, the lost thing wasn't the Space Dog manga. Rather, the lost thing was the talented artist. It's not that Kugayama lost Space Dog. It's that Space Dog lost Kugayama.
Deep.
Deep thoughts.
It's real deep, man.
Yeah, it would be more deep if I didn't write Space Dog in all those sentences. And then we get...
I don't know.
It gives
it more an air of the universe is listening.
Yeah. Then we get the thesis for the entire arc, which is where Tanabe says expectations are born from a despairingly large difference in skill.
Yes.
That's basically what he gets. That's basically what we get out of all this.
I mean, it's a dubious premise, but that is what this episode is based around.
Yep.
So we come back to the present, and Ibarra is like, here, Oreki, here's your manga back. Tell your sister thanks. And then she starts glaring at him for whatever reason.
Probably because she doesn't know that he solved everything and is upset that he wasn't able to solve everything.
I think given the fact that she knew that Satoshi was hamming it up, I think she knows that those two were up to something.
Well, they're kind of always up to something, to be fair. Sometimes it's something like getting the girls out in bikinis to see Oreki work.
And Chitana's like, well, what about the last four?
Like, well, we'll just all buy a second one. And that's when we find out that, you know, they must have already bought the ones that they said that they were going to buy, but later...
I guess.
I don't know. Bad math. Again, when we first started with all this bad math, I said all that matters is we're going to go from 200 copies to zero, and we've now done it.
It's true.
We've gotten there. Now gotten to the zero copies.
Now that we've gotten there, Chitanda says, good. Now all we need to do is unravel this whole Jumanji thing.
I can now focus all of my energy and curiosity into figuring out Jumanji. And Oreki's like, and please, no.
No, and then she's like, crazy face, give in to my desires.
Give in to my eyes. Like, please, no, no. And then Satoshi opens a stupid mouth.
I think he's figured out a thing
I
or two about it.
Might have figured out one or two things.
Oreki gets, like, a two Satoshi.
It's always that two Satoshi.
And then they decide to go to dinner. Both girls get crazy face, and everyone goes to Chitanda's house.
Yep.
The end.
Well, they are, Oreki is forced into going. I like a scene where everybody is jumping up and down in joy that they've sold all the copies. Satoshi's doing a dance. The girls are holding hands, jumping on his hand. And... Oreki's pachi, 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 pachi. He's just clapping.
Yay.
We did it.
He's so excited.
And then he's forced to go.
Always excited.
And then we leave the Bunkasai. Now wait, brother. Hold on.
Yes?
Before we go any further.
Uh-huh.
Was the cactus watching for Jumanji at the beginning of the episode?
He was.
He was there?
He was there. Good. He's watching. Always.
He knew. Was the cactus there to celebrate good times come on?
Well, yeah, because his hands were already in the air. Like, he just didn't care.
That's true. Good old Cactus. He really sees us through.
He knows.
He knows.
He knows.
He's seen it all. Good old Cactus. Love Cactus.
So the next time, are the mountains sunny?
Are they?
And Satoshi's horrified by something.
Well, if I recall, the next episode, do you know how normally they're in the geoprep room? Sticking around and being giant talking heads?
Are they somewhere else?
How about if we go to the library? We go to the library.
Oh, that's very shocking. I'm shocked.
But after that, it'll be episode 19.
Does a kid go to an office?
A kid gets called to the office.
Hooray!
I hope you're ready to take copious notes. Because the whole theory of that episode is, the kid got called to the office, let me explain to you, Chitanda, why everything I do is just BS, as we're going to logically explain a wild conclusion.
So, insofar as this episode, yeah. And perhaps the entire arc,
sure.
What was your best?
The best? Oh, I don't know. I like it all. Like, it's really tight.
Yeah.
It doesn't look like the story is going to be that tight when you start off with all these crazy different things. You got Corpse by Evening, you have stuff getting stolen, and you got all these copies of Hyouka that need to get sold, and it looks like there's just no way they're going to come together. But they do. They all come together in the end.
Actually, mine's kind of a variation on that. I see where you're coming from with the nice and neat thing, but I like how everything was put to rest, but they're all still really complicated reasons, and not everything is actually resolved. And I kind of like the messiness of that, because the mysteries were solved.
Yeah, that's true, but not the interpersonal relationships.
The actual conflicts were not.
Yeah, no, I agree with that.
I like the fact that there's some messy life going
on. Yeah, what's really good about this whole arc and the whole sort of thesis about, you know, people are just going to be better than you at stuff when you're in high school and you're young, and you're just gonna have to deal with it. And in high school is when you start learning that people are just better than you at stuff, and you're gonna have to deal with it. That's a very real teen angst, and this this arc deals with that really well. It shows it, and it shows character going through it, though not necessarily overcoming it yet, just them dealing with it.
So what was your worst?
Hikaru no Go, man. Why are you here?
Why is he there?
Why are you here? Were you in the books and actually did something useful and you just sort of stuck around? Little
I doubt it.
Bowl cut little freak.
Wow.
What a such jerk. Hate. What a jerk. Hey, Astronomy Club was in this and they were great and they didn't do anything, but they had some fun, zany times. But Hikaru no Go just sort of shows up to be a jerk.
So my worst was, and you're probably going to disagree with me on this, but I, as much as I like everything sort of being wrapped up and not completely being resolved, I don't like that three completely independent things were conveniently tied up with the same device that is inadequacy.
Yeah, well.
So, like, if it were two in the arc, you'd be like, okay, well, that's an interesting turn of play. I like the play of that. Little on the iffy side, but, you know, two is okay. I can get that. But three starts setting off the really?
Is it really that? Because it really is just one thing that has to do with inadequacy. The whole inadequacy thing just revolves around the fact that Corpse by Evening, like, existed and was really, really good.
But to have three seemingly independent things tied up with that one thing.
Just, I don't know.
Like I say, two, okay, great. Three?
Well, what's the like, third? What's the third?
Third was Ibarra's arc. And well, to be
what,
honest...
Then what were all three then?
You got Satoshi.
Yeah, but that's not really... Satoshi's that really thing. Has nothing to do with Corpse by Evening. That just has to do with the mystery. A mystery just exists that he is not able to solve. It's irrelevant that it has to do with
Corpse
by Evening.
The whole thing with inadequacy starts in this episode with him.
Oh, yeah.
So he's got his inadequacy problems. Then you've got Tanabe's inadequacy problems. And then finally, you have Ibarra's and Reimu's inadequacy problems. Yeah. But really, four. But I feel like overall, the Ibarra arc didn't really serve a purpose.
Well, I think that's an arc that's just not quote-unquote for us. I think that's for a different audience.
I mean, I never felt invested in it.
I mean,
there's a lot of bullying. It came down to, hey, you like this manga? I like it too much. Huff, huff. And she leaves. That's it. We don't really get a resolution to why was she even being bullied in the first place.
I mean, that's true. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would agree with mm-hmm. that.
And that was the main thrust of, like, the first two, three episodes of this arc was Ibarra's getting bullied. How come? Dunno.
Yeah, that's fair.
You never get that.
I'd buy that complaint. So, but again, like, I just think that arc is not quote unquote for us. I think that that's an arc
that
appeals
may be.
To a different
that
demographic that we are not a part of.
What was your MVP?
MVP. Ooh, is it Cactus? Being there the whole time, seeing us through.
Or Eggplant.
Ooh. Ah. Pumpkin.
Pumpkin did help us all get through those tough times.
Either that or Chemistry. For providing us with an explosion.
My MVP, at least for this episode, was Oreki for being a shrewd SOB.
It's like, well, I see that you're impressed, but how about some lovely-dovely blackmail?
Blackmail? And on top of that, explosions. Would you like some of those? I have some, right here.
Let me blackmail you into blackmail by promising you explosions if you agree to my blackmail. You drive
indeed.
A hard bargain. I don't want to pay blackmail, but I do like explosions.
Yeah, I would say this is probably the second best arc. I know that the people I've talked to, it's like their first best arc.
Yeah, it's a real good one.
Favorite.
It's a real good one.
But I think I favor the movie one over this one so far.
I can definitely see that one, especially since the movie one is a lot more of a... It's 100% a mystery with, like, the crippling self-doubt themes being there, but not necessarily important to the... Well, it's not important for the mystery aspect of it.
That's just character.
Where this one, the character and the personal conflicts are interwoven with the mystery, which some people are going to appreciate, but some people would rather just have the mystery.
I just don't like things. I like things being convenient. I don't like them being that convenient.
I take umbrage with you thinking that it's all that convenient rather than just sort of like that's how the world works. But
coincidence.
Okay. That's not even really a coincidence. Again, it boils down to there was a really great piece of literature written by a high school student and a bunch of people don't know how to deal with it. Also, Satoshi's ongoing problems, which we've known about since like episode heck one, we've known he has issues with how good
he is fake man of the world.
Yeah, we know he has issues with how good Oreki is at solving dumb mysteries. We've known that since like episode one. It's just come to a head here in recent episodes.
Yeah.
Really starting an arc back with the movie arc.
So next time we finally leave this arc and we go to the mountains, which may or may not be sunny.
Yep.
Or may not actually be mountains.
And I think it's another bummer one, honestly. If I'm starting to remember it now, and I think it's another bummer one.
Oh boy.
Oh boy.
That sounds exciting.
Not for our gang, but it does have a bummer.
Oh. Well, those happen.
While recording this, I am wearing my new moon pudding t-shirt.
Did you get a moon pudding t-shirt?
Moon pudding.
Did you see my tweet about Artemis?
Yeah.
Apparently it sparked some sort of debate.
I imagine. I like the idea, but he is just a jerk for no good reason.
Well, I mean, so he's like the only straight man in that show.
You're not wrong.
Because normally in a show like that, it would be Mamoru. Mamoru would be the straight man.
Yeah, but he's too busy miracle romancing it up.
Yeah, he's too far in deep. He has too much of a vested interest in these goings on. But Artemis, he's like, whatever.
Yeah, but he's not. He's just always a jerk. If they played up his world weariness more, I would subscribe to that theory better. But you know.
Well, they're too busy building up Mina's personality.
What personality? She is a block of wood. She really is. She's the
yes,
best
and
episode.
Also,
the best Minako episode is where Minako and Jupiter are like both on a date with the same person in the Amazon trio, and that episode is pure gold. That's like Minako was actually cool in that episode, and that episode is great.
Yeah, they're not going to get to that for years.
But that's a good ways down the road, and that's probably the best Minako episode for the entire show. So,
Poor Minako.
Well, yeah, I suppose so.
I also don't like the whole Amy and Makoto are a thing.
Oh, well.
Thing. Like, I'm with Jordan on that
one.
I was
right?
Why can't they just be friends? They're just friends. Holy crap.
Yeah, well, what do you do?
Yeah. So have you watched anything this week?
More Voltron. I mean, I've been traveling, but I've watched
all of Voltron.
Some Voltron. You know, it's not bad. We got to the second Robeast, and the Robeast designs are pretty good. They're very angel-esque in that they all are both the ones we've seen so far, very different and require a different way of going about attacking them. And that's real cool.
Hmm.
It can be a little blunt sometimes, some of its themes. And I think overall, any complaints I have are the fact that I think it's written for a younger audience, and that's not really a complaint. That's just, I'm 30 and I'm watching a show that's really built for, you know, 8 to 13 year olds.
Well, oh, no. You get a lot of that when you're old.
Yeah. Well, I mean, oh no, what a complaint.
Everything should be for you.
No.
What's up with this world?
No. Those are complaints for my enjoyment, but it's not like built for me to super love an infinite amount. Just enjoy, and I am enjoying it. So I recommend giving it a watch. That's pretty cool.
I watched on Crunchyroll, or I'm going to watch on Crunchyroll, this show called Space Patrol something or other.
Yeah, it's by Trigger. I've not seen it. I've seen lots of GIFs, and the animation does look spectacular, but I haven't.
I was going to watch it. I wasn't going to do anything with it,
yeah,
to be honest.
That's fair.
But I took a look at the picture of it when I was doing last week's show notes. Mm-hmm. I was like, okay, this one looks a lot more Trigger-esque than Kiz Neighbor does.
Yeah, it's real. It's real style.
And the synopsis is more Trigger-esque. Like, this crap is bananas.
Yeah, it is banoo-noos.
Yeah, so I was going to watch an episode for that this week, but since we had to record early, I didn't get a chance.
Yeah, well. Yeah, it's supposed to be pretty good. At least the animation is supposed to be gorgeous. All the like stills and GIFs I've seen are like nice animation.
Yeah, and it's only 12 episodes, I think.
So
turns out Sailor Moon Crystal is also only going to be 12 episodes.
Oh, well, what do you do?
Because guess who showed up this week?
Saturn with full transformation sequence.
She does not have a transformation sequence.
Oh,
I'm happy to say. I think this has been the best episode of Crystal so far.
I mean, it's not hard.
You're right. I mean, it's not. But they use a lot of reanimations, like all the transformation things from last episode they used again. They used all the attack animations they had in the first half. Just to sort of show you how inept and how useless everyone was. Because then Sailor Moon's all like, everything's lost. I'm going to take my Holy Grail. And then I'm going to suicide bomb right into this old Pharaoh 90. And of course, everyone's sad about that. And as soon as she's gone, all the talismans like, well, we figured this might happen. So time to summon the old Saturn. And then she shows up and just knocks heads. Like, she doesn't waste any time. She shows up. It's like, oh, I guess this is happening right now. Let me stab Pharaoh 90 in the face with my stick.
Moon stick.
No, glaive stick.
Stick.
She's like,
stab him in the face. Is it called glaive stick?
No. Oh, just silence glaive.
Oh.
And then she's like, okay, well, I guess now it's time for hashtag real talk. Death ribbon revolution.
Oh, that doesn't sound good.
And explodes everything. I do like, though, that here they make a hard distinction, which has never been made officially before, between Death Ribbon Revolution and the actual silence. Because everyone's always wondered, are they the same thing? Are they not the same thing? No one's really sure. And now we know for absolute certain that they are not the same.
That's nice.
And then she brings down the glaive at the end, and she brings it down so hard that the episode ends. Find out what happens next time.
Yeah, well, what do you do?
So I do have a funny story.
All right, hit me with your funny story.
So several times this week, I've been asked for anime recommendations out of the frickin' blue.
Well, you know, it happens.
So the recruiter that got me my new job.
Sure.
He walks in the office. He's like, hey, you want to grab lunch this week? I'm like, oh, okay. So I go with him to lunch. We're talking about stuff. He's like, I majored in religion in college. I'm like, that's interesting. I'm interested in like Eastern religion and stuff, like Japan. He's like, oh, you know a lot about Japan? I'm like, I know some things about Japan, yeah. He's like, do you watch anime? I'm like, I've seen a couple or two of these exotic Far East cartoons.
I have known to dabble in the Japanimation.
He's like, well, can you recommend me some? I'm like, oh, okay.
And how deep do you want to go?
So then I was like, do you like Pokemans? Because I could recommend you, like, if Pokemon were like a real thing, and kids actually had like real life Pokemon in the real world, that'd be a cool show, right? So I recommend Narutaru. That'd be a good starter. And then another one that I would recommend for newbies, there's a show that's about giving of yourself, helping others, you know, when there's no one else around to help, especially at night, and you're a nurse during the night shift.
Yeah, yeah, some night shift nurses. Yeah, yeah.
Night shift nurses.
Really?
Yeah.
I've always heard that show's a little poopy.
It is, I think. It's kind of crap. But I feel like there are some redeeming aspects to it.
That's good.
A lot of selflessness.
Yeah. I hear it's real jazz influenced.
I think so,
There's a lot of scat in there, from what I understand.
I believe so, yeah.
I don't know much else about it.
No, I didn't actually recognize
it. Well, I would imagine not.
And if anyone's listening, don't go watch those things.
Don't watch those things. Don't watch Night
Especially
Shift.
Especially the second one.
You just don't. It's infamous.
I just went the standard. He's like, I like post-apocalyptic stuff. I'm like, well, Cowboy Bebop is technically, you know, post-apocalyptic because they blew up the moon.
It's space cowboys. It's not post-apocalyptic. So it's fine. Space cowboys.
I mean, it doesn't have zombies. I think he was looking for zombies.
Well, in which case, you watch Jojo's Bizarre Adventure. It's got zombies.
It does have zombies in spades, popping out of horses and everything.
Yeah.
So speaking of Jojo's.
Yeah. Jojo's Bizarre Adventure.
And zombies and vampires.
And brains.
And corpses.
And corpses.
And everything. So many things. JoJo episode 17.
Yeah. The deeper plan. Sounds hot.
Ooh.
Ooh. Be part of the deeper plan. Deepest plan. Nice. We open upon a
field of corpses.
A field of corpses and a ziggurat. Our boys, the PBs, as we all know, the Pillar Boys. They're called the PBs. I always call them the PBs in my notes. The elder ones. They're sitting around talking about the masks and how, you know, they're real cool and they're great and how they can pierce a human brain, but man, they just don't pierce our immortal brains.
In fact, we need more power.
Oh ho ho. I love, hold on. The phrase immortal brain is great.
I do like immortal brain.
The fact that
brain.
This gives us like a keyword, like a vocab keyword, immortal brain, to go along with all the other brains we like to talk about. Entire brains, whole brains, immortal brains.
What about entire immortal brains?
We might see an entire immortal brain later on in this episode.
I just realized that if ACDC, who says that we need more power, yeah. If he's Jeremy Clarkson, his partner is Cars.
Yeah.
This has to be on purpose.
I doubt it. They're bands. This is ages ago. This was written in the 80s.
Jeremy Clarkson was around in the 80s.
Well, was Top Gear?
It may not have been specifically, but this line could have been inserted.
Maybe.
In 2012.
Either way, they need to find what I'm pretty sure is a Gundam, right?
Kind
Super
of.
Super Asia? I'm pretty sure that's a Gundam.
It is a Gundam.
No, that's Master Asia. Ah, nuts. Close. Anyway, here's the...
Cars holds up a red jewel.
Yeah, an Asia. A red stone of Asia.
Yeah, he's like, okay, so check this out. And if I hold it next to this candle...
Watch, it lasers your face. Isn't that cool?
It lasers your face. What could it be? Could it be... It's a laser.
It's a
basically...
They got laser
lasers.
Rocks.
They're lasers.
Laser stones.
That's it.
It refracts light billions of times, making it strong and pure. That's literally what a laser does.
But it's not enough. This one is rejected. And he throws the mask onto a pile of masks, like a reject. It's probably the one that Dio got. Dio's a reject vampire.
Yeah, so here's the grand plan. I don't know if they bring it up exactly in this, but the grand plan is this, you know, Cars and the boys want to just be like the highest level of BA-ness that one could possibly be. And Cars invented all these stone masks so they could, you know, get things stronger and stronger and stronger. Well, unfortunately, none of them work on them. So they need one of these little red stuff. They need the Super Asia redstone of Asia to power up one of these masks so strong that it can pierce their entire brains, making them basically into a vampire pillar man.
And then they can, and I quote, conquer the sun.
Well, they mean that as in, like, they can be daywalkers because they can't walk in the sun right now.
I mean, sure.
Granted, knowing these guys, they may actually be trying to conquer the sun. No, that's fair.
Like, they might want to go walking on the sun.
Oh, might as well be, at least.
They're Smash Mouth.
Oh.
Basically.
They are all stars.
So we flash forward, and Lisa has been explaining all of these things.
Also, Susie Q's here. Hi, Susie Q.
Hi, Susie Q. You are a maid, and you happen to have a flawless Asia stone. Yeah, so she brings out to Lisa a flawless Asia stone within a necklace.
Yep.
Seems like a bad thing to keep around.
Well, we do bring that up. We do bring that up because as soon as this is here and shoots lasers, because that's what these things do, Jojo's like, okay, so look, that stone's really cool and really powerful and the Pillar Men want it. Why don't we smash it? Because if we do, quote, if you break it, they will cry like babies.
I mean,
always a step ahead, that Joseph Joestar.
To be fair, this is the best idea he's had
in a long time.
This whole show.
You're not wrong. Well,
why don't we just smash it?
Oh, smash it.
Because then he won't try to come kill us.
Lisa says, well, okay, so we can't because according to a prophecy by someone somewhere, the only way to kill the PBs is with this stone for reasons and stuff. And that's the plot of the show. Shut up, Jojo. We're not breaking the rock.
Yeah.
I'm glad they brought up this plot hole and then filled in the plot hole with extra plot hole.
I mean, it fits. I mean, you could always put a hole in a hole.
And that's what they do?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Hey, voice of reason here. We could break it. Voice of the author? No. How about that?
I just thought of something.
It's like a DM who just like doesn't want to deal with it. It's like it's magic or something. Shut up. You can't deal with it. Prophecies.
I think that the interesting thing might be she holds it up to the sun, which causes a giant laser to come out of it, right?
Hmm.
Well, the Pillar Men aren't going to come out during the day, so they're not going to have the sun to like laze them with. Mm-hmm. So it is the 40s. They have invented, you know, flashlights.
Yeah.
They could just keep a flashlight around and this thing and just
laze
them in the face.
Technically, now we have a bit of a problem with the candle scene earlier, but we'll not worry about that.
It sort of sucks the fire out.
Well, yeah. But generally what hurts these guys, and we do know this because that's how they keep a Santana under wraps, is technically it's the UV light and sunlight that hurts these guys. How the Super Asia Stone turned regular flame, which is, you know, infrared, into murder you rays, we'll not worry about that too much. But generally it's the UV light that messes with these things. So a flashlight wouldn't work. Though that candle did, but again, we'll not worry about that. Hammond is non-destructive, but it can break rocks.
Yes, now that you've explained that, I'm more confused than I was before.
No.
I just thought it was a magic rock.
Nah, I mean, it probably amplifies UV rays, or maybe it can turn any light into UV light. Maybe they make ultraviolet lasers, but it can do it out of any sort of light source.
Also, it's interesting, because they talk about, both AC/DC, when they're talking about they need a flawless one.
Yeah, perfect one.
And then Lisa, when she brings out the flawless one, has a very pronounced flaw in it.
Oh, the little cross flaw?
Yeah, there's a cross.
They're just like that. That's how you know it's perfect.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's how the crystals do.
Yeah, that's how it works.
It's fine.
Look, crystalline structural is a very mysterious thing. And a very perfect one will do that. All the different lattices line up and refract in such a way. Look, it's fine. Also, look, it's like symbol. That's why vampires and crosses don't get along, because it reminds them of this stone.
I see.
See, it all makes sense.
Yes. Fine. So speaking of making sense.
See, mate, we go to the op.
Well, no, Lisa says, wait, you guys are going to take a final exam.
Final exam.
You got to beat Messina and Loggins.
Yes, please go
do Jojo,
that.
You are officially going to the dink.
Oh, no, I had a better joke for that later. I have a better danger zone.
I mean, we can make that joke all day.
Well, we can. Well, not all day, but...
all day.
Yeah.
Relentless. So we get the op. And the title, the deeper plan.
Yeah.
We cut back and Messina and...
Tight rope fight.
Having a tight rope fight.
It's like pipe wrench fight, which is a little thing of take on me, take me on. Either way,
but you know what?
The tight rope fight is boring.
Let's go to Jojo and Long.
So instead we're going to go there. And here is where we find out that Loggins himself has found the danger zone, and the danger zone name is AC/DC, who has punched out his lungs.
No, he's kicked out his lungs with his foot.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yes, Jojo's final has been upgraded. It is no longer going to be a choose-your-own...
It's now a practical exam.
It's now practical, which is AC/DC is here to get the Superstone of Asia and has killed Kenny Loggins.
He's killed Kenny Loggins, and he's brought his pincushion pauldrons.
He has.
I mean, it looks like he went out and found some wood and put some nails in it.
Look, he...
And just, hey guys,
he
look,
recently,
I have nail pauldrons.
After waking up, he was like, you know, I wonder what I've missed. And he was at the tape cassette store from 1980, in 1930, and was like, you know, this Hellraiser guy, he looks pretty cool. What's he's about? And he got some ideas.
Some interesting ideas.
Some very interesting ideas. And I was like, yeah, I can incorporate this in my look.
Yeah.
And some of these techniques of fighting and torture I can probably use as well.
That's true. He says to Jojo, to think, that woman in that stone right over there. And I could go over there, but damn it, Jojo. You're always in my way.
Well, hold on. Before that, it's a very, very important scene. You're skipping right over, because Jojo has gone over to his fallen teacher, Kenny Loggins.
Oh, yes. Oh,
and
yes.
First off, he's like, well, you know, I wanted to torture Kenny Loggins because of how hard he made me suffer in a very Lisa-esque way.
He yelled at him for like a whole 3 weeks.
Yeah, like that's terrible.
What a tyrant.
But here's the deal. Jojo says he took out Kenny Loggins' lungs, and Kenny Loggins, lungs are important to Hammond users.
They are.
That sucks that he took out their lungs. Jojo, lungs are important to everybody. Everybody.
I dare say, perhaps, they are important for other people besides Hammond users.
I think everybody needs their lungs, aside from vampires, zombies, and pillar boys. But yeah, no, everybody needs lungs. It's not something special. Not just the danger zone that needs lungs. It's everybody.
Well, you know.
Everybody needs them, except fish. But yeah, everybody needs them.
Oh, dear. Okay.
They are important to Hamon users, but also everyone. Everyone, indeed. Jojo. He didn't take anatomy. That's okay. Well, not.
He didn't. We saw his heart. He has no idea what's going on.
He was just describing it. It's like there's a fan theory that one of the reasons the Pokedex entries are so bonkers are because they're not actually written by the 10-year-old who has the Pokedex. So when they see stuff, they're like, yeah, that fire slug's a million degrees. It's a million. You know, millions of degrees. That
makes so much sense.
That balloon ghost is scary. It's like he wants to carry me. They do. They want to carry me away. Absolutely, that's what they do. A Pikachu, it zaps me with like a billion volts.
At least.
Billions.
Speaking of volts, so AC/DC walks over to Jojo over this giant pit of spikes. So
this whole fight is going to take place over a pit of spikes.
Yes.
And our good PB,
he steps
AC/DC
on/through them.
Yeah, like the ain't no thing.
Like, he's stepping on the spikes.
They go through his feet and he is not caring.
Jojo, on the other hand, moves towards him as well, using Hamon to step on the spikes.
Yep.
Tips.
Yeah, it's real cool.
Yeah, he's not being gross.
No, he is not.
AC/DC spends this entire episode being really gross.
He is super gross.
And Jojo calls out to him. He's like, hey, AC/DC, it's 6 days early, but I guess I'll take your ring now.
Yeah, I guess we'll have this out.
And he's like, you know what? How about instead you get out of the way because I ain't got time for this.
I have an exchange here written down, and
it's a good one.
AC/DC turns to Jojo and says, Jojo, if you touch me, you'll lose half your body. And Jojo says, make me. That's not how smack talk works, Jojo.
No. Although, before that, AC/DC says, I don't have time for this nonsense. Let's get out of my way. Yeah. And Jojo says, you know, you've got more time than I do.
Yeah, you're like immortal.
Like, huh, that was sharp. I think you're smarter now.
Yeah.
But people who look at me like that are going to die.
Yeah, like, come on. Like, why would you do that?
Like, I'm glad that you've got some wit now. You're able to throw some puns about, but I hate people who use puns. So
they are the highest/lowest form of humor.
You would know.
I would.
In response, Jojo does a dance.
Yeah. AC/DC decides to just knock Joseph Joestar out of the way and moves to backhand him. But Jojo makes a Facebook account and pokes AC/DC. With his Hamon finger right through his hand. After declaring that Jojo will only ever moves if there's dog poop in his way.
Very, very well thought out, Jojo. Yeah. Well, although, you know, he thrusts his finger through AC/DC's palm. Mm-hmm. Say, are there things that you can do with one's palm if something is, like, sitting on it? Do you know of anything that you could do with that?
So if something were in the middle of my, if something were to land right here in the middle of my palm, like in such a way that my fingers were like that, So if it's, especially if it were sticking through my hand, I could bend my wrist in weird ways and do like a backflip to try and like break their finger.
Yes.
I mean, I know,
which
I
is
could,
what AC/DC does.
I know I could do that, but I don't think there's anything else I could do. I don't think I could grab, like, I have my phone here in my hand, and I can turn my hand over at the wrist, but I can't, like, close my fingers at all. So I don't think I could ever.
Yeah, so that's basically what happens here. AC/DC says that, wow, he poked through my finger.
That's a lot of control to have just learned in 3 weeks. That's pretty good.
Right. Then he grabs Jojo's hands.
Yeah.
You know, you'd think that one would have thought of that first, but it's Jojo. And he says, yeah, it's cool skills and all, but you don't have enough badges to train me.
Yeah.
And then he jumps over Jojo and twists and says, if I break off your finger, you'll never use it again.
You're not wrong.
Generally speaking, in the 40s, yes, that's true.
But who has twisted whom?
Oh, Jojo has flipped over AC/DC and has wrapped a fine silk thread.
Covered in vegetable oil. Very important.
It is covered in vegetable oil.
We need it.
Because without it, it wouldn't conduct Hamon.
Well, not as well. These are more Hamon rules.
So many.
There are a lot.
We're getting so many.
Yeah, so Jojo has used a garret made of silk. And he charges up with Hamon and slices off AC/DC's arm. Now, it's also important to note that this garret is not only tied to Jojo, but he also, Jojo slipped it around the finger of Loggins' body.
Middle finger.
Middle did he? I didn't notice that.
He did.
That's a good touch.
I like that.
Good touch. Because Jojo says he wants first blood to go to his dead instructor. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure poking a Hammond-charged finger through AC/DC's hand might actually count as first blood.
I mean,
granted,
yes.
Neither of these are Rambo movies, so technically speaking, neither of them are first blood, but you know.
Well, we've already seen at least one time in the last 5 seconds where Jojo didn't exactly think something through.
You mean everything?
So, yeah. This whole episode is basically just who thought of what first.
Yeah.
And it's usually not Jojo.
For a lot of it.
So, Jojo starts mouthing about the art of war.
Yeah.
Because AC/DC's arm has flown off and landed on a spike.
Yep. As if there's not a bone in
victory,
it.
Victory, dude. Like Sun Tzu said, is decided before the battle's even fought.
True facts.
So, you know, lay traps. I skipped school a lot, but Granny Erina made sure I
stopped
studied
me in the
history
streets.
Good. I'm like, good job, Erina.
The streets.
Like, you knew he was skipping school, but you're like, well, as long as he's studying history.
He won't be doomed to repeat it. It's true.
Sun Tzu.
Good for him.
Is Sun Tzu history?
It's historical. Either way, Jojo then spin kicks AC/DC's entire arm, and AC/DC starts flipping out, and Jojo's like, huh, are you upset I disintegrated your arm? You mad, bro? You mad?
You mad, bro?
You mad? Do you even lift? You mad?
It's like, good, because I'm more mad. That ring you put in my throat has made it so I haven't been able to sleep right for weeks.
AC/DC then breaks down.
His sleeves are soaked through.
Through with
both.
Tears.
Both sleeves. And everything else.
I sort of forgot
soaked
this part,
tears.
And I was like, is this some JoJo-esque, like, runaway scheme that AC/DC is doing? Like, JoJo himself comments, this is embarrassing. He's throwing a tantrum.
He also says, some things are creepier than anger. Yeah,
and it's everything.
Because this guy should be, like, super upset about his arm?
Yeah, and he's like blubbering like
but
a little baby. He just got his candy.
I should probably just kill him quickly.
Yeah.
Put him out of his misery.
But what's this?
Uh-oh.
It's time to get serious.
He's like, you know, I feel better now. Sometimes when I'm about to lose
I
it,
just need a little cry.
I cry a lot
just
gotta
get
and
a little,
I calm down.
Just gotta cry it out, man. Some people hug it
it's
out.
It's like my zen.
I gotta cry it out.
Tower relax.
So the now super serious AC/DC. It's like, okay, well, you know, I lost my arm. That sucks. A good thing there's a whole body over here I can just get bits from. So he just goes over, chops off Kenny Loggins' arm, and just puts it on himself.
I do like how right before that, he's like, oh, Sun Tzu, you said?
Yeah.
I believe you mentioned him. I know that guy. I met him.
Yeah. He seemed
cool guy,
cool.
Though. He's a cool
may
guy.
May have taught him one or two things. May have,
but it's
may,
cool.
May have eaten him.
I've longed for a worthy opponent, and here you is.
And here you are.
And Jojo is, like, really unnerved by this whole thing. As one might be, given the situation.
What, for some reason here, I have, oh no, Jojo is standing right in front of AC/DC and he doesn't know what he's doing. I'm not quite sure what that's in reference to. Just have this written here.
I agree.
I don't know why I have that.
AC/DC's
I think
like,
it's
aw.
Because Kenny Loggins starts to melt.
Well, he does, yes.
Yeah, it's weird. This is where we start the gross part of the episode.
Jojo says, this guy's nuts. I can't read him. I've always read my enemies and used their feelings against them.
That must be what it was in reference to.
I'm like, have you?
Yeah, because remember,
have you really?
He always does that thing where he like tells somebody what they're going to say right before they say it.
Yes, but that's not really using their feelings against them.
Well, he's constantly...
That's just being a jerk.
I mean, he did poke... He did boop Santana on the nose.
Yes. Truly a tactical advantage to Jojo in that one.
Positive. He did win that fight, after all. With no loss to himself.
True.
He may have lost a Nazi, true. But they aren't real people.
Speaking of, Loggins' head explodes.
Yes.
And his brain is on fire.
His brain... Gross.
AC/DC explains, though, because this is weird, animals' temperature rises. You know, the blood temperature rises when it moves or fights disease.
Yeah, that's true.
I can make mine 500 degrees.
Does he
shoot it out?
Does he say that? Does he say specifically 500 degrees?
He does.
Okay, because here's...
I don't know which scale, sure, but sure,
all,
500.
All of them. AC/DC explains that Wham is a master of wind, what with his really stupid divine sandstorm attack, which is really dumb. Right. I'm not going to worry about it, but he's a master of wind. Now, good old AC/DC, good old Acker-Dacker here, is a master of fire and can literally make his blood boil. So, you know, uh-huh, there's that. To which JoJo says, well, balls to that.
Actually, wait. Before we go on to his balls.
Okay, before we discuss balls.
So let's think about this a second.
Okay.
Wham can control wind.
Yes.
AC/DC can control fire.
Yeah.
Zappelli can control water.
Sure.
With his bubble spray.
Yeah.
JoJo has heart.
And balls.
I assume Kars has like earth, and they're all going to summon Captain Planet.
Doubtful.
Really?
Yeah.
No Captain Planet?
Well, it depends. I mean, there is... Does that count as Captain Planet? I don't know. Yeah, I don't think so.
Okay. Well, we'll see. I'm going to hold on to that.
I will say someone gets summoned, but you'd be hard-pressed to call it Captain Planet.
We'll see.
Maybe.
Does he have a mullet?
No.
Ugh. Okay. Yeah, you're getting to that part, aren't you?
Yeah. You know, I just had to pause it on that part, and it's the worst.
Oh, good job. So, yeah, JoJo says, you know, cool story, bro.
Hot story,
actually.
How about
a clacker volley? And he splits AC/DC's hand with his balls.
Actually, AC/DC splits his hand as to avoid the balls.
Oh, okay. I see.
Yeah.
AC/DC explains that now he can shoot blood at JoJo's head and turn his brain into stew.
He does say that.
And then I just have written here, like, I just stopped my note. It's like, oh, gross.
Yeah, it's the worst.
His fingernails are lifting up and things are coming out.
Yeah, dude. Oh. I have it here. Then his fingernails lift up like little doors, veins come out, and it gives me the wiggums. Just straight up.
Fingernail stuff is the worst.
We all know
that
the worst part of the entire American Ring movie is how part of the little video is the person poking their finger through a nail and having the fingernail pop up. It's like, that's the worst. And that's what this whole, like, episode is.
No.
The Wiggums. Either way, it gives the whole episode the Wiggums, because we're about to cut to commercial with Wham doing fingernail tentacle
stuff.
Things. Because he shoots his veins.
You know, this is why he's the burning king.
Yeah, because he shoots his blood vessels out, and they hit JoJo in the mask, while the wine that would make somebody a Viking on Lisa's table breaks.
An omen
with Susie Q. There
something
in the
is
background.
Amiss.
Hi, Susie Q.
So yeah, we get put from our break.
Meanwhile, back at the tightrope fight, they're having just a good old time.
Yeah, they are evenly matched.
They're doing great.
And Messina says, you know, maybe we should stop because if we continue, one of us is gonna die. So I concede. You're better.
You're better.
You even burned all the hair off my right arm, and I am indeed shamed.
Yeah, I mean, shaved. Did you say shaved or shamed?
Shaved. Both.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go. Yeah. Nice.
Shaved.
Shaved. I don't think that's a portmanteau we're going to be able to get out.
No.
Portman Joe.
So Zappelli goes to his backpack and gets out some binoculars to check on old Joseph Joestar's progress.
And he negs JoJo so hard. He's been reading up on the game, and he knows how to neg like the pros over here.
Who are you talking about?
Caesar?
Zappelli?
Yeah, Zappelli.
Or Messina?
Oh, no, Zappelli definitely knows how to neg. He picks up all those ladies all the time. Yeah, he knows all these little tricks. He invented
the one
game.
Here who's really negging is Messina.
Really?
He's like, why do you care about that good-for-nothing over there? Zappelli's like, I'm only this strong because I didn't want him to outpace me. Plus, he's a really good guy deep down.
Deep down, past all of the gross, the rude, and how terrible he is. Yeah, after you get past all of the JoJo-ness. There's something in there.
And Messina comes back with, you know, you're really bad at making friends, but when you do, I guess it's true love.
Toot toot. Toot toot.
But Zappelli doesn't have time to ruminate on this because, oh no!
Yep.
There's an AC/DC over there.
Yeah, AC/DC calls it a clever dodge that JoJo, you know, dodged.
Well, kind of.
He sort of just fell back.
Well, he blocked his nasty veins with his mask.
Yeah, that he did.
And now he has a fire face.
Yep. And his mask comes off as it hits a spike. And JoJo says probably the best line of the episode.
I think so.
He says, blast it. These sexy lips finally come out from under the mask and you just burned them, you bastard.
I don't have blasted. I have damn his blood.
Yeah, whichever works. I mean,
my sexy lips finally came out.
Yeah.
And you've burned them.
You burned my sexy lips.
Bastard.
And now it looks like we're going to have a role reversal here, because AC/DC starts doing the mind read tricks that JoJo likes to do.
He's like, oh, you're making it with the wit, but you know what? I bet you're scheming.
Yeah.
You always. And JoJo has been found out, and his plans are starting to flounder, and so is he.
Yeah, because he's like, oh, so here's my plan. I'm gonna get some string, and I'm gonna weave it amongst all the spikes, and then I'll pull it taut like a net, and then I'll blast the dude from, yeah, I'll use my bind attack.
And AC/DC's like, ha 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 ha.
Bet you're gonna do your bind attack, you're dumb.
Plus, while he's telling him exactly what his plan is, he starts stabbing his own arm with the spikes.
Yeah.
Which is also slightly unnerving.
To let all of his veins out so he can Imra-cool it up. And just tentacle all over the place.
He says, here is my Burning King's prison.
Yeah. Ugh.
It's at least not any kind of nail stuff.
Yeah, at least. Yet. Yeah, so AC/DC, instead of JoJo being able to make the web of silken string like his plan was, AC/DC makes a web of gross veins. So, you
but
know.
Lo, JoJo's hat is shrinking.
Oh, why is that? Why could JoJo's hat?
Because he's using it as his string and unraveling it around the spike.
That is true.
It's like, you are actually caught in my web,
Boom.
And it's 100% wool. And it conducts Hamon just fine without vegetable oil.
Sure, yeah, I guess. You know,
like,
why not?
Dude, stop telling people what your trap is until you've sprung it.
Well, you see that there are traps upon traps.
Because AC/DC then says, your next line will be, I'll wipe that smirk off your face.
And then JoJo says, I'll wipe that smirk. Hey, that's mine. That's the thing I do. Why would you do that?
And also, I'm the one spinning the web.
Yeah.
With
Take
veins
it.
That are now coming out of his
toenails. Stop it.
Like, I'm okay with the normal amount of gross in this show, even though it weirds you out, but the nails thing?
Yeah, like, dude, come on. Come on, just be decent for two seconds. Come on, why would you do that? Yep, so AC/DC uses his veins to cut all of JoJo's string, and, you know, then he starts menacing JoJo with his gross, drippy vein. That sounds really terrible.
Well, I have written down here, this is now a tentacle porn with veins.
Oh, yeah.
And right after that, AC/DC said, my veins
yeah,
have given you some new
holes. Yeah, I have that written down,
yep.
too.
Yep. It's a tentacle porn.
It's real hot because his blood's boiling. You see.
AC/DC then says,
yeah.
You'll be a lovely birthday cake covered in candles.
Yeah, of blood.
I have a question, though. Yeah. How does Pillar Man know what birthday cake is?
You know, I was going to say that too, but I decided it wasn't worth writing down. But no, you're absolutely right, because I had that same question. I was like, would he really know?
Like,
what cultural references is he got himself
2,000 years of all the things you've seen in like the last 20-some days, birthday cakes was one of them? I don't know. I don't know. How does he know?
So basically, here's the deal. They're ultimate beings, right?
Right.
Right. So basically what they were doing is they were going to try and stop this giant amorphous sphere of, I guess, evil, from crashing into the earth. And what they did is they started going through the dictionary, and they were cool with everything, thinking everything was cool. So they saw birthday cake, they saw love and all that. But then they got to the W.
Got to war?
And saw war.
Oh, no.
And then they were like, oh, dude, that's no good. They missed Holocaust and murder, but they got to war, and they're like, oh, no, that's not good. And that's when they turned all evil and decided to murderate everybody.
Are you talking about sexy glorious men's or sexy awesome fifth elements?
Well, they're both ultimate beings.
But which one has a multipass?
I mean, Lilu Dallas has a multipass.
I think she would trump them then.
I'm not sure about that.
She has a multipass and they don't.
That's true. But they have gross vein things.
She met a chick with gross veiny things and stones in her gut.
It's not the same. These guys are looking for a stone and they can put their guts on the outside of themselves and not die.
As is witnessed right now.
Yeah.
Gross. So Zappelli has been watching this whole thing from afar and hasn't really moved to help.
No, he's fine. It's cool.
Messina explains, if JoJo fails, we're dead.
Yeah, we're pretty dead.
So let's not go help, because he's too far away.
Yeah, he's too far away. We should probably go make sure Lisa's cool. So they bail to go protect Lisa and Master Asia with his shining finger.
I mean, that's an okay excuse, but we know they can run on water.
Well, don't worry about it.
They could go help.
They could.
They're friends.
friends help
teamwork.
Friend? Again, it's because a Messina knows that this is turned into a practical exam, so it's all right.
So yeah, AC/DC, as we cut back, is like, writhe in eternal despair.
Is this the end of our hero? Were AC/DC's plans truly deeper? Well, considering JoJo is posing with his eyes closed and is smirking and chuckling, probably not.
You just lost, son, because you've been asleep for 2,000 years.
JoJo then explains, illusions, Ackerdacker.
Illusions. Oh, dear.
In the 18th and 19th century, you see, sleight of hand became entertainment.
It's true.
I'm a fan. I can illusion. Yeah. And so he produces a string. Yeah. Where'd that come from?
Das?
Where'd it come from? ACDC's like, but I caught that. I cut it all to shreds. In many places. What's going on?
He's like, well, I use that weird trick that illusionists can that let you cut a string, but when you pull it taut, it all works. I don't know how that works technically. Illusions.
It's essentially two. There are actually two strings, and they are sort of
knots,
quote, tied together, so that if you cut one, there's still one that's there.
Yeah, it's. I don't know how it works. Illusions. It's illusions.
Illusions.
Michael.
Yes.
So JoJo uses rap attack, and then he gets to take back his trick, where he gets to say his things right before AC/DC says them, and it's really nice.
My veins will move faster than your pathetic Hamon.
He says, right before he says, my veins will move faster than your pathetic Hamon.
And then JoJo gets to say something that we have not heard in quite some time.
Uh-huh.
Hamon overdrive!
He does! He gets to actually hit overdrive. It's nice.
It is nice. And guess what? AC/DC just can't.
Yeah.
He
turns
can't.
Into Skeletor.
He's getting sliced 12 ways to Sunday.
Yeah.
He's like, but I'm the highest life form.
I'm the best.
This sucks. I'm gonna spike you in the face. Oh, wait. That doesn't work either. Oh, crap.
Yeah.
Then his face melts off.
His face melts off. And it turns out he was Skeletor this whole time because he's got some weird metal skull thing in his horn. And
so, yeah, AC/DC's body releases some kind of energy, which JoJo says is the energy of a millennia of life and stuff. He thanks Loggins as AC/DC explodes. And then he picks up the old ring.
And drinks the gross, snotty stuff that comes out of it to dissolve one of
the. He does bring up a valid point, though. He's like, Santana turned to stone and feigned death when we did this to him. Yeah, but
this guy just totally evaporated.
Huh. Yeah, why is he different?
Isn't that weird?
I mean, maybe I'm just awesome.
Yeah, I mean, he is pretty cool. His Hamon has gotten a lot better.
Yeah, yeah. He's all fine. And he thinks that maybe he's used his head too much in this fight.
His shoulders
are sore.
Maybe his shoulder hurts because he has AC/DC's entire brain clutched to his back.
He didn't destroy the entire
AC/DC
brain.
AC/DC has turned to Krang and has hitched a ride on JoJo's back.
I'm telling you, they should have emblazoned that on their family crest.
Destroy the entire brain?
The whole thing.
A whole brain. Not part of the brain. The entire brain.
If they had taught JoJo anything from Erina's history lessons, it should have been,
destroy the entire
what's lesson
brain?
One? Did he follow it? Nope.
The entire brain.
Didn't.
The entire brain.
Although I'm wondering what the brain thinks it's going to do when JoJo gets back to the mansion and any number of people are like, hey, dude,
you got an entire brain back there. You see that entire brain?
Yeah.
Got one of those.
Try that place you can't scratch.
You got an entire brain back there.
And then we get roundabout. So what was your best of the ultimate fight so far?
I mean, it's a pretty good fight. I like the plans within plans. I always like a good plan within plans fight. That's why I like Death Note so much. That being said, this isn't a very good one, but...
Well, no. I mean, JoJo is the one making the plans within plans.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he's not exactly the best.
Not the best planner. Not gonna lie.
I think my best was the fact we got to see Hamon overdrive again.
Yeah, that's pretty nice. It's nice to see that. Granted, it's not actually a good Hamon overdrive. He just shoots Hamon into the yarn of his hat to frag good old AC/DC.
But it's overdrive.
Yeah.
What was your worst?
It grows still, man. Come on.
Yeah, the nails
gross.
Thing.
We're being gross.
I can't deal
and
with the nails.
The entire brain? Bleh.
Can brains even do that?
Well,
I don't think brains can do
this
that.
This is the brain of an ultimate being. Look, Dio's head could stay alive just fine without a body and fly around and float and blah, blah, blah.
Grab onto things.
With veins and still do stingy, space stingy ripper eyes. So I'm pretty sure if you are like three steps above Dio vampireness, then I'm sure that you can have your entire brain. So.
Oh, probably. Okay, so who do you have for MVP?
Suzy Q.
Really?
I like Suzy Q.
Why is that?
I just like Suzy Q. She's in the episode.
She hasn't done anything yet. Mm-hmm. My MVP is AC/DC.
Either that or, okay, so runner-up runner-up would be Loggins for finally finding the danger zone.
That's fair. Yeah, AC/DC actually had all of JoJo's plans figured out.
Yeah, which is pretty cool.
And my problem with how it worked out is they even show us a little diagram of how that rope thing works.
Yeah.
And if he had cut just one random point in the string, sure, JoJo totally would have won because he's 50-50 shot. But he cut many points, so he was bound to cut both strings.
Don't worry about
it. So he's either incredibly unlucky or a victim of plot convenience, because otherwise he had JoJo on the ropes.
This is JoJo. On the ropes. I get it.
And so that's why I'm saying he's MVP. If it weren't for plot, he would have won.
I mean, all of his plans did end up being all in vain.
That's almost as bad as the fingernail thing. So next time we get both nude and dead ladies, apparently.
Yeah, we get floating brains. Gotta watch.
Floating brains, lots of blood. And because Lisa is in a shonen anime, even though she's cool seinen, and awesome, she needs to be naked sometimes, besides the op. So, bathhouse.
Yeah.
Is this going to be like Oreki and Chitanda, where one of them hopes that they're going to go into a mixed bath?
I'm sure JoJo wants them to be in a mixed bath constantly. But yeah.
She is cute, he says.
But he would never marry someone like that.
Hey everyone, thanks for listening. If you have comments or questions about Hyouka, JoJo, or just want our inane take on anything anime related, you can get in touch with us on Facebook or Twitter at Aniki Podcast. Also, make sure to check out the show notes for bonus content and links to stuff we talked about this time. So, thanks for listening, and see you next time on Aniki.